Hello and welcome to a brand new show on Medibiz TV Tablet, wherein we receive questions and doubts from the viewers as mails. And today we have with us Dr. Abby Abraham, who is going to tell us more about nephrology. Let us welcome him to the program. Welcome, Doctor.
Thank you.
First of all, we would like to know more about you.
Presently, I am working as a senior consultant at Lakeshore Hospital, Cochin. I had my entire medical education at a Christian Medical College, Vellore, where I did my MBBS, MD, DM and BNB. And after my postdoctoral training in nephrology, I was there as a faculty member for 7 years. And then I left CMC as an associate professor. Since last 12 years, I've been associated with the Lakeshore Hospital.
Doctor, we have got some questions and doubts from the viewers, mainly from UA.
Yes.
So we'll move on to the questions. First mail is from Shruti from Alain. What causes kidney failure or disease? And what are some kidney failure symptoms?
Kidney failure is actually defined as a reduced function of the kidney. In fact, there are two different types of kidney failure. One is acute kidney failure. The other type is chronic kidney failure. Acute kidney failure is also called acute kidney injury. And chronic kidney failure is called chronic kidney disease. And there are many causes for each of this category. Acute kidney failure is actually characterized by a sudden and often irreversible kidney failure, which occurs as a result of many diseases. Any sudden drop in blood pressure, hemorrhage, major infections like post-op infection, major surgery, sudden drugs, and all these things can precipitate an acute kidney failure or acute kidney injury. Patient is often sick and usually patient in the hospital and may require a dialysis. And if prompt treatment measures are initiated, this is a reversible condition. On the other hand, chronic kidney disease or chronic kidney failure is a slow and progressive condition. And unfortunately, patient may not have any symptoms in the beginning. The symptoms may appear only when the disease progresses.
The other question that she has asked is, what can I do to make my kidneys better? And can you explain me what is Procrit and why is Procrit often needed in chronic kidney disease?
A healthy person usually, if he doesn't have any other risk factor, usually does not develop any kidney failure. The risk factors for developing kidney failure are diseases like hypertension, diabetes, kidney stones, or if you are in the habit of taking painkiller medications too often, or you need to take other medicines on a regular basis. So these are the important causes of chronic kidney failure. So if you don't have any of these conditions, it's very unlikely that you'll develop kidney failure. But often kidney failure can occur due to idiopathic causes or unknown causes also. So what is generally recommended is that everybody should undergo periodic medical checkup. Once a year, you can check yourself, get yourself screened completely, so that even if there is any early signs of kidney failure, that can be detected. Procrit is actually a brand name of a medicine called erythropoietin. Erythropoietin is a hormone which is required for augmenting the production of red blood cells in the body. In kidney failure, often there is anemia, and this anemia is due to a deficiency of this particular hormone called erythropoietin. And this is the reason by which it is supplemented.
And lastly, she asked, can I do my dialysis at home? And what is an AV fistula?
Dialysis can be done at home also. There are two different types of dialysis. One is called hemodialysis, and the other one is called peritoneal dialysis. Hemodialysis is often done in the hospital, where blood from the patient is taken out and is run through a machine and comes in contact with a fluid, and where there is a transfer of solutes, the waste materials in the blood will move to the dialysate solution, and what is needed for the body will be taken from the dialysate solution. So this is called hemodialysis, and this is usually done in the hospital. But if you have a dialysis treatment plan, that is if you have a water treatment plan and a dialysis machine, it can be done at home also. The other modality of dialysis called CA peritoneal dialysis, also called continuous ambulatory peritoneal dialysis. This is a treatment which can be done at home by the person himself, by himself or herself. During this technique, fluid is actually infused into the abdominal cavity at regular intervals. And while the fluid is in the abdominal cavity, it comes in contact with the blood and the toxic materials are removed. So this can be done at home and by the patient himself or herself.
And she has even asked, what is an AV fistula?
AV fistula is actually a requirement for starting hemodialysis. For doing hemodialysis, you need to get the blood of the patient. This can be done by placing a catheter in one of the large veins of the body. But unfortunately, these catheters can't be kept for a long time. So what is normally done is actually an AV fistula is created. AV fistula is actually a connection between an artery and a vein, which is made by one of the vascular surgeons. This is usually done in one of the arms, upper arm or forearm. So once the blood flows directly from the artery to the vein, there will be a lot of pressure difference and the veins become dilated. So after constructing AV fistula, it becomes mature. That's the terminology used. It becomes mature after a period of 2 to 3 months. When it becomes mature, the veins or the blood vessels are dilated and can be punctured to access blood.
So, doctor, now we will move on to the next question. It's from Selina Abu Dhabi. What is nephrology and what is chronic kidney disease?
Nephrology is actually study of nephros or kidney. Nephros is actually a Greek word of kidney. So, basically, study of kidney and kidney disease called nephrology. As opposed to urology, urologists basically deal with the surgical problems of the kidney, and the nephrologists basically deal with the medical problems of the kidney.
And she have asked, can you explain what are the 5 stages of CKD and what tests are done to assess and monitor kidney function?
Chronic kidney disease is defined as a condition in which there is a impairment or reduction in the kidney function or any structural or functional abnormality lasting for more than 3 months. It can be classified into various stages, 5 to 6 stages, depending on the filtration rate or glomerular filtration rate from stage 1 to stage 5. Stage 1, if it is more than 90 ml, stage 2, 60 to 89 ml, stage 3, 30 to 59 ml, stage 4, 15 to 29 ml, and stage 5, less than 15 ml. This is the classification. But by and large speaking, if it is stage 5, it means it is severe kidney failure. And soon or pretty soon, patient may have to go for dialysis or any such renal replacement therapy. And see, these are the stages of chronic kidney disease. I was referring to chronic kidney disease earlier, which is a condition characterized by kidney disease, which is characterized by slow and gradual progression.
So next mail from Amanda, Dubai. How is diabetes control related to kidney function? And how is blood pressure control related to kidney function?
Both diabetes and blood pressure, hypertension are important, very important causes of kidney failure. In fact, type 2 diabetes, that's the diabetes which usually occurs in the Middle Ages, this is the most important cause of kidney failure in the world. And followed by diabetes, the hypertension is probably the second most important cause of kidney failure in the world. So if you don't take good control of diabetes, it may lead to kidney failure in the long run. And the first manifestation of kidney abnormality or kidney failure in diabetes is actually leakage of protein in the urine called microalbuminuria or proteinuria. And once this happens, which means there is a structural damage to the kidney, and a lot of precaution has to be initiated at this stage. And once this happens, patient will be screened at a regular interval to check for the progression of the disease. And if diabetes is not treated well, and if this kidney disease which occurs as a complication of diabetes or diabetic nephropathy, if it is not treated well, it can gradually progress over a period of time, eventually resulting in severe kidney failure or stage 5 chronic kidney disease. And this is a stage at which patient may require renal replacement therapy or dialysis or transplantation. Just like diabetes, hypertension is also an important cause of kidney disease. If it is not controlled, if it remains uncontrolled for a long time, it can result in chronic kidney disease. And it's very important to keep the blood pressure as close to the normal range. What is recommended is actually for blood pressure control, it should be less than 140 by 90. 140 is a systolic blood pressure and 90 is a diastolic blood pressure. And for diabetes, what is recommended is actually the fasting blood sugar should be less than 110-120, and the postprandial, that's the blood sugar after food, should be less than 160-170, in that range. And there is another measurement which is also used for assessment of glycemic control or blood sugar control called, it's called HbA1c. This gives you the 3 months average of blood sugar, and it should be less than 7%. So if blood sugar and blood pressure are kept as close to the normal range, to a great extent, the potential complication of diabetic nephropathy can be avoided.
What are the treatments available for diabetes?
Lots of treatments are available for diabetes. In the initial stages of diabetes, what is required is actually a lifestyle modification. Diet has to be adjusted. The total calories have to be restricted. Simple sugars like sweets will have to be reduced. And sufficient exercise patient has to do. So these are the lifestyle modification. Then going to medications, there are various medications available for diabetes. Diabetes medications, insulin is there, but one may not have to go for insulin in the beginning itself. There are drugs like oral hypoglycemic agents. Then there is a drug called metformin, which is a very useful and very safe drug, which has been there since last 30 to 40 years. This is usually recommended as the first drug for diabetes control unless there is a contraindication. So if control is not achieved with metformin, other drugs can be achieved. Other drugs can be used. And insulin is usually started when adequate blood sugar control is not achieved with a combination of dietary modification, lifestyle adjustment, and oral hypoglycemic agents.
The other question that she has asked is, why do I need to take multiple blood pressure medications, and how does diet affect kidney function?
And regarding the first question, hypertension is a condition which can occur usually after the age of 35 years. And most of the time, you will not be able to identify a cause for this, in which is called essential hypertension. And in less than 5% of the cases of hypertension, a cause can be identified. It's called secondary hypertension. So in most of the cases of hypertension, you will not be able to treat the cause. You can only control the blood pressure. And various medications are available for controlling blood pressure. But like diabetes, lifestyle modification like salt restriction is very important for the control of blood pressure as well. And regarding blood pressure, it is not the number of medicines one is taking, it is actually the target blood pressure that is more important. Blood pressure has to be kept less than 140 by 90. Many drugs are available for controlling blood pressure like calcium channel blockers, angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors, beta blockers, centrally acting drugs, etc. One will have to start with one drug or two drugs depending on the severity of blood pressure, but sometimes, particularly patients with kidney failure, may require multiple drugs. Because I know I have certain few patients who require 5 to 6 drugs for control of blood pressure.
Can you tell us what are the types of diabetes?
There are two important types of diabetes. One is called type 1 diabetes, the other one is called type 2 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes usually begins in the children, can occur a bit late also, and in this condition there is a total insulin deficiency. And type 2 diabetes, insulin deficiency can be there, but it occurs at a much later stage, which means treatment is probably different in both conditions. In type 1 diabetes, insulin is required. From the beginning itself, insulin is required. Without insulin, the child or the diabetic patient will not be able to survive, may develop a complication called diabetic ketoacidosis. On the other hand, type 2 diabetes can initially, depending on the severity of diabetes, sometimes can be controlled with diet alone, and sometimes patient may require presence of additional other medications. And late stages, this so-called type 2 diabetes, which is also called non-insulin dependent diabetes, there is something which I have called beta cell failure, which can occur in this type of diabetes also, during which stage the patient will start requiring some insulin also. So patients with type 2 diabetes also may require insulin at later stages of diabetes.
So moving on to the next question. This mail is from Nadim from Sharjah. Are there medications which I should avoid with CKD? And what are the treatment options for kidney failure?
Chronic kidney disease is a disease which needs to be managed very, very carefully, because if you're not careful or if your doctor is not careful, this can result in faster progression of the disease. And if CKD progresses faster, it may require initiation of what's called renal replacement therapy. So you have to be very careful about the treatment of CKD. And some medications are particularly harmful in patients who have CKD. That is particularly painkiller medications called non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. For example, Brufen, Vovaran, Paroxicam, such drugs are available over the counter. Very often patients have the habit of going to a medical shop and collecting the medicine from there directly without following the advice of a doctor. So use of these drugs should be avoided by patients who have chronic kidney disease. On the other hand, paracetamol, which is a drug which can be used for treating fever, is relatively safe in chronic kidney disease and can be used. Up to 3 tablets, 500 milligram, 3 tablets or 2 tablets per day can be safely used. But non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs should be absolutely avoided. There are certain antibiotics like aminoglycoside antibiotics and certain other drugs. These drugs are often given by the doctors only. So the doctors will know which are the drugs to be avoided in a chronic kidney disease. But from a patient point of view, the most important thing is to avoid non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or painkiller medications.
So doctor, if the patient is allergic to the medicines, what kind of medicines are provided for them?
So in which case those medicines will not be avoided, and alternative medicines are available for most conditions, so one need not worry about it. But then there are some occasional or rare patients who have allergy to paracetamol, and unfortunately there is no other safe substitute available for paracetamol. But otherwise, for most other drugs, substitutes are available.
And the other question that he have asked is, what is dialysis and what is vascular access?
Dialysis is a treatment for kidney failure. Dialysis is a process during which patient's blood comes in contact with an artificially prepared solution called dialysate, and there is a free exchange of solutes between the blood and the dialysate. During the process of dialysis, patient's blood and this dialysate solution will be separated by what's called a semi-permeable membrane. So there will be osmosis which will be taking place across the membrane. So all the toxins in the patient's blood will move to the dialysate site, and all the required chemicals needed for the patient will move from the dialysate site to the patient's blood. This happens during hemodialysis as well as peritoneal dialysis. As I mentioned earlier, there are two different types of dialysis. One is called hemodialysis and the peritoneal dialysis. During hemodialysis, the contact or the exchange takes place between the patient's blood and this particular dialysate or the solution, which is outside the body. When the blood passes through the membrane, which is kept in a machine, but when you do peritoneal dialysis, this exchange between the blood and the solution takes place in the abdominal cavity. And regarding the different types of vascular accesses, you need vascular accesses to do hemodialysis, because you need to take the blood out of the patient, run it through a machine, clean it, and give it back to the patient. So you need vascular access. There are different types of vascular access. One is a dialysis catheter. The catheter can be placed in one of the large veins of the patient's body, jugular vein, subclavian vein, femoral vein. These are the large veins of the patient. It can be placed by a person or a doctor who is experienced in placing the vein, because multiple complications can be associated with. So the doctor has to be familiar with the procedure. And usually this dialysis catheter is placed for acute dialysis, or for starting from patient's dialysis on for a patient's chronic kidney disease also, if it has to be started as an emergency. And these catheters are usually kept for maybe few weeks, maximum few months if it is a permanent catheter. And if the patient requires dialysis for a longer time, what is preferred is an AV fistula. An AV fistula is an access which is prepared well in advance. Suppose you have a patient who is being followed up by a particular doctor, you know he has chronic kidney disease, and you know that he will be requiring dialysis in a few months' time, then you tell the patient that such a situation will arise, and the patient is referred to a vascular surgeon for constructing an AV fistula. And I was talking to AV fistula a bit earlier. So AV fistula is a permanent form of access. The only thing, after construction of AV fistula, it takes maybe a couple of months for the AV fistula to become functional. So the different types of vascular access are: one is dialysis catheter, temporary catheter or permanent catheter, and AV fistula.
Moving on to the next question. This mail is from Fahad from Ajman. What does it mean to be board certified nephrologist? And what is the difference between a nephrologist and a urologist?
Board certification is a qualification offered by United States of America. See, like, you have your basic training in medicine, and during which process you go through various specialties, and then you spend many years in this particular specialty, nephrology specialty, and after which you become board certified. So after spending several years in this particular specialty, and after writing an exam, you become board certified in nephrology. But in India, we have a different system. For example, we have a MD general medicine. After that, we go through the specialty, which is also for about 3 years. It's called DM, Doctor of Medicine. So different countries have different nomenclature for the degree. And the difference between nephrology and urology is that both basically deal with the disease of the kidney, but nephrologists deal with the medical problems and the urologists deal with the surgical problems. For example, if there is kidney failure or conditions like nephrotic syndrome, which is characterized by leakage of protein, or there is acute nephritis or chronic kidney disease, these are problems which are managed or looked after by the nephrologist. A nephrologist is basically a physician who has had further qualification in this particular field of nephrology. And on the other hand, urologist is a surgeon who is basically a general surgeon who has specialized in this field, who operates on the kidney and the urinary tract. For example, if there is a stone sitting in the kidney that needs to be removed, or if there is a cancer which has to be operated, this is done by the urologist. And for kidney transplantation, it's a team approach or combined approach. The medical problems are managed, the medications, various medications which the patient need are managed by the nephrologist, but the transplant per se is done by the urologist or the transplant surgeon.
The other question that he has asked is, what is chronic kidney disease and do I need a referral to see a renalist center for kidney care physician?
Yeah, I was actually referring to chronic kidney disease earlier. Chronic kidney disease means that there is a reduced function of the kidney, from a functioning of the kidney, which has been there for more than 3 months. It's certainly a chronic condition. It is it's something which has to be dealt by an expert only, preferably a nephrologist. So if you have chronic kidney disease, better that you are looked after by a nephrologist. So you...
The other question that he has asked is, what are electronic health records and do I have a choice of which renal center for kidney care office to visit?
Yeah, electronic health records, see, most of the hospitals still don't have electronic health records. Most hospitals still have only paper records. But, you know, this is a, you know, better way of storing and recording medical information so that can be kept forever. In our hospital also, we are actually slowly moving to electronic medical records. And if you have electronic medical records, it can be accessed at any time, even after several years. Patient can, the entire information can be put in a CD or in a thumb drive and given to the patient. It can be, the entire information can be emailed to the patient. So those advantages is there. So in future, all hospitals will be having only electronic medical records, but till today that has not happened, but that is the way it is evolving.
So now moving on to the last question. The last mail is from Isha from Abu Dhabi. What is a renal sonogram and do I need to fast for a renal sonogram?
Renal sonogram is basically ultrasound examination, particularly related to the kidney. It's not important to fast before the procedure. Fasting is required, like for example, if you need a sonogram which looks at your stomach, gallbladder, so then fasting is required. But if it is only meant for the kidneys, fasting is not required. But often they'll tell you to drink a lot of water so that your bladder is full, and they will ask you to empty the bladder and recheck the scan again to make sure that you're able to void completely. But fasting is often not required for a renal ultrasound.
Even she has asked, can I just drink more water to flush out my kidneys? And what are the most common cause of chronic kidney disease? And what is kidney failure?
It is important to keep a person adequately hydrated. But drinking several liters of water probably doesn't help and it is not required either. See, the amount of water a person drinks depends on the basic working condition. If you are leading a sedentary life, working in an air-conditioned office, you probably won't have to drink much of water. But on the other hand, if you are in the fields, if you are a hard-working manual labor, you'll be sweating all the time, getting exposed to very hot, humid weather, and you may have to drink plenty of water. If you are in an office which is air-conditioned, drinking a lot of water is probably not required. But drinking adequate amount of water is always important. And studies have shown that if you drink adequate amount of water, it probably reduces the risk of developing chronic kidney disease. So keep yourself sufficiently hydrated. The other indication for drinking sufficient quantity of water is we have a risk of kidney stones. Those who have kidney stones are also encouraged to drink a lot of water. They should drink sufficient water so that they pass at least 2.5 to 3 liters of urine every day.
Doctor, lastly, what advice you would like to give to the viewers?
Chronic kidney disease is a major health problem and it is slowly emerging as a global pandemic. The important causes of chronic kidney diseases are, as I mentioned earlier, diabetes and hypertension. So if you have these conditions, you should watch very carefully for earliest signs and symptoms of chronic kidney disease. You require periodic medical checkup, and if you detect even the slightest abnormality, for example, characterized by microalbuminuria, very strict or vigorous control of diabetes and hypertension is required. And drink sufficient quantity of water and avoid the use of painkiller medications unnecessarily.
Thanks a lot for being a part of our program, Doctor. So that was Dr. Ebi Abraham with us. If you have any queries, please do feel free to contact us on tablet@medibistv.com. Until we meet next time with a new topic, this is me, Naina, signing off.